Thanks for introduction. Hello, everyone. So welcome to my talk, Offensive Embedded Exploitation, Getting Your Hands Dirty with IoT and Embedded System. So this talk is basically fill the gap between application security, network security, and embedded security. Okay, so let's get started with the introduction agenda. So agenda for this talk is we will first have an introduction, then we will see what is the minimum requirement for pen testing, for setting up a machine for pen testing IoT and embedded system. Then as usual, we perform a first recognition, then we will have some firmware kind of stuff, and then dynamic testing, and lastly we will be touch basing some portion of fuzzing, reverse engineering, and exploit development. Okay, so let me introduce myself. I'm security whiz. I have dozens of exploits in embedded systems, and I'm just a product security researcher, and I love to share my knowledge, so I present at conferences. And let's get introduced with IoT. So I have classified IoT in three criteria, basically: industrial IoT, inhuman IoT, and others IoT. So IoT is booming everywhere. As you can see, everything is getting smart. Everything is getting smart. Everyone wants perfection at their work. Everyone wants to speed up their tasks. So industrial IoT is currently a vast. There are vast users for industrial IoT. So here are some examples. Like, there are smart manufacturing companies. They want to build their product in excellent way. They don't want some human errors. That's why they are automating stuff with small robots. Also, there is a smart government. So for smart government, I have an excellent example. Like, let's say in a city, there are street lights. So there are almost 50,000 to 1 lakh street lights are there in one city, right? So so let's assume if government thinks to implement a smart street light, smart street light for a complete city, then how the things will be like? Not all streets are always busy during the night time, but street lights are still on. So what they can do, they can implement some small modules, some IoT modules, which will turn on the light only if someone passes through there, and rest of the time light will be turned off. So this thing gonna save. I'm getting too much noise from Discord. Just a second. So let's assume that if the government thinks to implement that small IoT devices into street lights, then what happens? Only when someone passes through that area, when sensor sends something, at that time only light will turn on, and rest of the time it will be in an off state. So this is gonna say this is gonna be pretty much useful. This is gonna save lots of electricity and lots of cost for the government. Okay. Mobility and Wi-Fi. Mobility is the key pillar for IoT, because one module called narrowband IoT is solely provided by a mobility company, like telecom. I'm just turning off this for having too much disturbance. So mobility is a key element which provides the connectivity to for IoT. Okay. Then smart digital citizen, that is VR. We are having smart watches, we are having smart eyewears, and we have smart wearables, multiple smart wearables we have. And the health is, smart health is the key element which is booming in IoT. As recently we were working on some project called IoT ambulance. So as soon as a patient gets inside to the ambulance, there are plenty of sensors will connect it to his body, and at that moment only he will start getting diagnosed. because doctor will receiving the real time data from just a second. There is too much disturbance again from this. It's kind of from where this noise is coming. Okay. So smart ambulance. So as soon as the patients enter inside the ambulance, some sensors will get connected to his body, and they will directly send real time data to the doctor, and accordingly, doctor will start treatment. So in some cases where there is a lots of traffic, where patients takes time to reach the hospital, at that moment, this thing like IoT ambulance gonna help a lot. So smart agriculture is also getting smart. Like some in rural areas, there is a concept of load shedding where they turn off the electricity, and they suddenly turns on the electricity at certain time at night time. Then what that farmer needs to wake up, and he have to go to all way to his farm, and he have to turn on the water supply to his farm. So if we have a small sensor, that sensor will automatically turns on the water supply when the soil is dried and electricity is available. So this kind of smart agriculture stuff can be implemented with the IoT. And a smart building, we have excellent example for this in next slide. And smart transport, Tesla is an amazing example. So like Tesla takes transportation to next level. Okay, so these all are industrial IoT. I have one example. Just those who are wearing an headphone, just reduce their voice for the next slide. And this is a inhuman IoT. So what inhuman IoT means? Those are the medical equipments which sits inside your body, and those are IoT equipments. Let's say insulin pump. Let's say you have a child diabetic patient with you, and she cannot take care of getting insulin done properly on time, or she may mess up with the quantity of insulin. So this smart pump can remotely, just a second, this smart pump can remotely triggers this stuff. Okay, so this looks like Discord is off, and still I'm getting notification here.
Kosev, do you need any help from me?
No, I'm just checking that too much notifications are getting, which is distracting the talk. So get the exiting Discord. Okay, is this good now, audio?
Yeah, that's good for me. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. So if you have a child diabetic patient who cannot take care of her insulin, so you can implement a IoT insulin pump so that you can remotely give a insulin to her. Similarly, there are pacemakers. So pacemakers ensures your heartbeat is proper and all for those who need it. And apart from this, we have a IoT for others, like from human and from apart from human and apart from industry, there are still IoT concepts which is working. Like you can see this cow here. So there is some company who is working on just getting. Excuse me, guys, just a minute. Just a second. Perfect. Okay, now there won't be any disturbances. Yeah, so there are companies who are still working on some IoT products for animal, like so that there will be a belt which will tie to their neck, and they will perform some pattern analysis, some behavior pattern analysis, and based on their behavior, they will generate an alert. And also, along with their behavior, they will check few things, like those sensors will perform a temperature monitor for your pet, and if there is anything critical that let's say your puppy needs to take to the dog, then it will highlight those stuff. Okay, so this is how we can see whole world is getting covered with IoT, and with a great here is one great example for IoT: digital building. Those who have put a headphone, please decrease the volume, that this is high sound radio. Yeah, so once I would like to visit this hotel, definitely. The Flyzy hotel is completely based on IoT. So there are no humans, only machines, and they are running a complete hotel. So with a great power, great responsibilities do come. So here we see why the security assessment of IoT is needed. So this gives a goosebump. Have you heard about a witchcraft? When we were a kid, used to grandparents used to tell that there is a witch who used to kill someone by taking some contracts by some those magical guys. Okay, so I don't know whether witchcraft works or not, but here you can see medicine pumps and pacemaker threat as a doctor simulated hack toward you. So these pacemakers or insulin are having some kind of remote connectivity. It might be a secured or most secured protocol they are using, more secure ways they are using for establishing communication. But there is some way through which you can remotely control it. Now let's assume if I set a heartbeat 500 beats per second, who can save you? No one, right? This is the most critical aspect of IoT. This is the most critical aspect for inhuman IoT. As we are building the devices who can control our body things, we should also get it tested from world security experts. Okay, so here you buy some stuff to give a surveillance to your house, but hackers turn into a spying machine. So here you can see the news: hackers break into a smart home, play inappropriate music, and communicate with the resident via camera. Isn't it scary? Like, I am always watching you. My eyes on you. So hacker can turn these devices. So this one attack was something like Mirai. Someone rewrote those exploits and run it. And I'm always feel like somebody is watching me. Listening to me. So you buy again a camera to keep a surveillance, but that camera is not giving. That camera is giving you surveillance, but also it is spying you only. No comments for this. Almost everyone have this one at their home, and this is the most critical. FDA recalls nearly 500,000 pacemakers over hacking. Similarly, the one example which I gave you at the starting. So the IoT security is pretty much crucial, and it's a super serious issue which needs to get discussed or which needs to get tested. Means every embedded device which is having a remote connectivity, we call it as an IoT device. But the assessment for the IoT device must be done. And also, it should give a user some kind of comfort that this device is not hackable, or what is the hackability of this device. So this is how the IoT security is important for everyone. Okay, so my case study for this talk is, can this decent looking IP phone change into a botnet? So some might be wondering, why IP phone? Every organization have this. So easiest target, every organization, like any large corporate you take where the 30,000 to 40,000 or to 50,000 employees are working, they must have 50,000 IP phones. Like one organization having 50,000 organization in one city. Let's assume there are 10 organizations. So how much it will be? 5 lakh IP phone? So 5 lakhs IP phone in a city, then think about a multiple city. It's around 20 lakhs. Think about a whole country now. It will be a millions and billions and trillions of IP phones we are having in one country. Now let's assume if you found one way to remotely exploit an IP phone, can't you exploit all the IP phones, all the connected IP phones, all the connected to all the internet connected IP phones? Right. And if you can control those millions and billions and trillions of IP phones, and if you just run a curl request, simple curl request, to get a Facebook.com or Google.com or Amazon.com, who can save their servers? No one, right? It will be a industry's biggest denial of service attack. Or with an army of 1 lakh bots, you can do anything. 1 million bots, you can do anything, right? No need to explain. Like that's not an idea behind this talk. Idea is to, it's just a case study that I think the security is important for all embedded system devices and IoT devices. Okay. So one disclaimer, this is purely educational purpose video, and I will be sole responsible for this video, and this represents my own thought, not my employer. Okay, standard disclaimer. Okay, so before we start thinking about this kind of attack, or before we start thinking about exploiting an IP phone, what we should have? We should have a setup. So wherever I give a talk, generally people come to me and say that we want to get started in IoT, but we don't have that hi-fi labs, or we don't have extra budget to purchase an extra accessories for IoT research. So I have classified this preparing the arsenal section into fields. One is a basic setup and one is an advanced setup. So let's have a look at basic setup. So first thing, which is freely available to everyone, that is Linux. So you don't need to pay for this, at least for Kali Linux, which I am using. So why Linux? Why not Windows? So if Windows say there is an unknown device connected, it will remain unknown till the time you don't give a proper driver to Windows. Okay. No offense against Windows. Okay, just one example. And if you connect that same unknown device to Linux, the messages, wire log messages, and hardware messages, kernel messages, everything will start giving you something like vendor ID, hardware ID, manufacturer ID, types of devices. So something Linux is trying to recognize it. Second more aspect is all embedded and IoT devices generally builds on MIPS or processor or ARM processor. So ARM architecture and MIPS architecture. And we may not always have the hardware with us. So sometimes we have firmware of the device and we have to test it. So to run those binaries, we need a QEMU emulator. And Linux works smoothly with a QEMU emulation for ARM and MIPS. So that is another important aspect to work on embedded system. Okay, third point is a vast community support is available for the Linux. So you will 100% found driver on some forum or some community of any you name it that product, and you will find it somewhere on internet. Okay, for Linux, for development environment, or for exploitation, for connection, for everything, huge community support is available. So these are few aspects. That's why I consider Linux is the most important. And also Linux gives the lowest level access to the operating system. That is that is advanced part. So Linux gives lowest level access to the operating system. That's why Linux is important. So JTAG. We are not an electronic guy. We are a security guy. But why we need a JTAG? We need a JTAG because it's a de facto standard interface for all chips. Sometimes you may not find any LAN card, any WAN card, any USB, any micro USB, mini USB port, or even UART will not found on the port, but definitely JTAG will be there. Sometimes pin points may not be there, but pins are definitely there for JTAG. So JTAG is known as a de facto standard for testing the hardware. And what happened is, like, you might have seen some QC pass, QA pass sign on that. So what happened is, like, when millions of hardware get generated, how you think that factory guys are ensuring that all hardware is working? Definitely they are not doing a QA of each and every hardware, right? Because it's going to take a huge manpower and also huge time. So what they do is generally they put JTAG connection, and with some RXTX they ensure that all PCB and all components on the PCB is working fine. So why we need a JTAG here? We can dump a firmware of device using JTAG. Okay. And when it comes to the IoT, what generally we think is wireless world, right? I want everything wireless, everything disconnected, no wires and no shit. So when it comes to the wireless, we should have something to test on those rays, right? Your regular Wi-Fi card cannot understand all this other protocol. It's running on lower frequency or higher frequency. So this one hardware called API Mote, it is required for testing. It is not mandatory, but it is good to test a wireless product like Zigbee, Z-Wave. If you have to test those kind of protocols, you need to snip those. To inject those packets or to perform a replay attack, you need API Mote kind of hardware to test. And the last and most important are connectors. So connectors, seriously, you are my life. So what are the connectors we need? We need extra LAN card, we need extra WAN card. This is a screwdriver set, general screwdriver set. We need for testing to open the device. And this is a Ubertooth. So Ubertooth is just an advanced Bluetooth device to perform a BLE, Bluetooth low energy attack or Bluetooth attacks. We need this hardware. And this may not sound familiar to you, but this is called a Shkira hardware. It allows you to connect to the UART, GPIO, SPI, and I2C, all four interfaces. So this is all-in-one connector. Whenever you order two for you, because generally this kind of connectors get broke very fast. So I have plenty of it with me. So and this one, HackRF. So Great Scott gadget, everyone might be aware of this. Those who are not, it is a radio frequency hacking gadget. Okay, so this is called a basic setup. All you need is this cost around not more than $1,000. All you need to spend is $1,000 for this setup. In $1,000 or $1,000 to $1,500, everything will get covered and you are good to start. And now let's look at the advanced setup. There is no limit for advanced setup. You can build your lab to whatever you want. New device will come to test. You have to get new connector, new PCBs to work. Everything will be new. And those will be here somewhere. So there is no limit for advanced setup. I taken this image from one of the Black Hat or DEF CON presentation. I love this image. And this looks really advanced lab. So for radio frequency also, you can use such kind of devices, many connectors, many wires. So there is no restriction. But to start with, you are good to start with a basic setup. Okay. So that's all we need for the for getting started to the IoT and embedded device testing. Not anything super critical hardware. Okay. So we talked about hardware. Now what about tools? Some software, right? We need a BinWalk. So BinWalk is an open source software. We need this for firmware extraction. We need a Firmadyne. It's not mandatory, but Firmadyne is a good framework for emulating the firmware and getting all QMU setup for MIPS and ARM ready to system. Burp Suite is the most loved proxy application through which you can intercept the request. Python. its life for automating lots of stuff. And AIDA Pro is the life, is the true weapon in embedded system. You might be wondering why AIDA Pro is here for reversing, because most of the embedded systems software are closed source. And to understand that, those software don't have main. So what, how you can correlate this? So that we have to reverse engineer the complete application, and then we have to understand how this hardware works. So why we do need to reverse engineer the hardware? To identify the backdoor inside the device. So some manufacturer might put some backdoors, like we heard that example, that there is one HP scanner, I don't know the brand of that scanner. It was posted in some government officials, and all the documents which are getting scanned was getting sent to that rivalry country's intelligence. It is super crucial. So like your printer firmware should get reverse engineered, and you should verify whether it is performing any malicious action or not, right? So this is super crucial. We don't know what code is doing inside this. Maybe it is working smooth in front of us, but maybe in backend it is performing some more actions. Like we don't know how at what kind of surveillance we are facing right now. Privacy is a myth. Okay, so to identify a backdoor account, to identify a critical vulnerability like code execution or privilege escalation, this generally we identify for using reverse engineering, and some silent listening services which might be spying you. So to identify such kind of bugs in the product or bugs in the hardware and product, we need a AIDA Pro. And most of the time we identify a critical vulnerability using this AIDA Pro. Okay, so one can use NSA Ghidra. I had a look at it. I really like that software too. And Radar Defense. Yeah. So Radar is also a cool software. So you can use Radar too instead of AIDA Pro. Okay. So basically, we need one reverse engineering software, one file system opener, one file system emulator software, one proxy tool, and Python. That's it. So looks like all these tools are free. It's not AIDA Pro, but community edition of AIDA is available, I think. Or else you can use NSA Ghidra, which is absolutely free. Okay. So this all we need to set up. Okay. Now, once we have this all hardware and software ready, the first thing which we are going to perform is reconnection. Like every other pen test, we have to perform a recon here also. So what kind of recon we have to perform? First thing is to know your device. So what falls in this section? Underlying operating system inside the device. So you think this is just a code? No. A whole operating system will be running here on this IP phone. You have to understand what operating system it is running. You have to understand the architecture of device. So is it a ARM device? Is it a MIPS device? Is it a MIPS, big ADN, little ADN, all these things. Third, what are the interfaces available to the device through which you can interact with the device? Let's say for this IP phone, what are interfaces you can see? Here, LAN card. This may have a Wi-Fi. This may have a Bluetooth, and if you open this, this may have a UART, or this may have a JTAG. So there is a list of communication. So some are standards, like some devices work with a USB only. So if you have a cable setup box at your home, all you need to do is you have to gather the firmware for a device. You have to rename that firmware, put it into a USB drive, just connect that USB drive. Device will automatically fetch that name from connected USB drive, and it will update itself. And then you can customize that firmware. You can add a reverse shell or bind shell to that firmware, and you can take a shell of your TV setup box, cable setup box. So you have to identify whether it is a MCU, only MCU, which is having hard-coded code, and it is working on and off like a digital I/O and analog I/O. Signal, or you have to also you have to verify whether it is a complete operating system, like many flavors of Linux available, like Yocto Linux is there, then RTOS is there, then many basically it's all Linux, and some devices are coming with Android. So what to say, your TV setup box is Android, your TV which is at your home, that is also Android. Okay, so some devices are Android, some devices are Linux, some devices are just MCU. Okay, so for us, we have to understand our device. So how can you communicate with the device, how device can communicate with the you with you, and what the device architecture is. So like here you have to make a mind map, and left side you can write device specifications which you can obtain from the product sheet or data manual that will be coming in next slide. Okay, and this about a device stuff, and right side you can perform an active recon, like how you can connect with the device. Okay, so when you are performing a device security assessment, when the first time I perform an assessment on IP phone, I was just blank. It's what I can do, what kind of security testing I can perform on this device. This looks dumb box to me. Just connect power on and I can make a call using IPBX. Nothing more I can do with this, right? But no, this is a whole new world of security testing. Okay, it is like a combination of network pen test plus web application security pen test plus source code review. So this all three comes to one place, that is device security assessment. So you should be always like this, I want more. So what you want? You should always ask for the product specification and data sheet, user manual, administration manual, security manual, if they are maintaining them. Okay, so here are some things I found from the specification, that is this device have this such protocol supported: SIPv2, RTP, RTCP, then NAPTR, SDUN, SDP. What to worry for this, right? So no, here is a worry. This device does not support a SIP TLS protocol. That means somehow if you manage to sit between IPBX and IP phone, this connection is plain text. So all you need to find is the perfect codec to decode the audio which the IPBX is using. So maybe your boss is talking with his boss regarding your appraisal. You just sit in between his IP phone and IPBX. You will come to know what he talks about you. Okay. Also, this support plain RTP, that means no SRTP, no secured communication is there. So that also you can sniff by sitting in between. Here you can see some SNMP V2 only. So I think V2, like getting community string for one IP phone, you have all trillions IP phone string. Okay, you purchase one, get officially one string, you can use it against other strings. TR-069 is called a technical report 069 protocol. If you are able to compromise this protocol, then you can literally reconfigure the device. Means whatever values you want to put, you can put it. Okay. So this protocol is generally used to get a diagnostic report or technical report of the device, also as well as you can reconfigure the device using this TR-069 protocol. Okay. Unless you provide a user manual, I will not trace your device. So here are some good interesting part from the user manual. So here it says management, firmware upgradable. Okay, you can upgrade the firmware of device. Web management interface, now web GUI is there. Password management, multiple user accounts are there. Remote and local syslog, okay, you can take a logs of device. Auto provisioning, TFTP, HTTP and HTTPS. Okay, that means device support HTTP, that we know, that web management interface. Then multi-user level support. Let's say if the administration body for this device may change the password for user admin from admin to admin at 123 or whatever the complex password they decide to choose, but there are still multiple users. So like support, technical, engineer, this kind of user account are still present. Okay. And I heard you like algorithm, so I used an algorithm to pick an algorithm. So you should always ask what kind of algorithms that you are using. So some might be wondering what are the algorithms and why they are in use in the device. So let's say there are plenty of companies who manufacture the router. Okay, and all routers have unique passwords. What do you think? How those passwords are generated? someone is randomly generating it and pasting? No. Why no? Because if the customer loses the password, factory password, and he did a factory reset of the device, then how he will get the password if he forgot the password? Like, he have to contact a ODM. And ODM, how ODM will identify? ODM will run some kind of algorithm based on few parameters, and he will generate a same password again. Okay, so for every Wi-Fi SSID, there are passwords, and those passwords are generated by algorithm. So you should be worried about those algorithms, because if the algorithm is weak, let's say if they are running MD5 some on the MAC address, gone. Like every router who is using this algorithm, you have a password for this, default password, and nobody bothers to change the password a lot for this thing. Generally, most of the people use same password. So you should be careful about reviewing the algorithm which are getting used. So it's just an example for Wi-Fi password. There are many other stuff for which this algorithm are in use. One of more important example is magic number. So what you think a magic number is? So magic number is something, when you take a device and to the service center, the device which is not working with you, you give it to the service center guy. Service center guy performs some codes, enter something on his device, or connect to the PC and enter something, flash it and give it to you. So what do you think what magic key does? Every devices have some kind of secret code. So those secret codes are called, sometimes it's called as a secret code, and sometimes it's called as a magic number. So let's say to gain extra access, for engineering access or debug access, you have to enter those specific codes. Let's say there is a GUI, you open a GUI, normally you set up a SSID, password, triple PoE connection parameters. But to upload the firmware to the router, if not available in normal mode, then you have to enter in engineer mode. So you type slash engineer, it will ask for a password. Those passwords are called magic number. So once you enter that magic number, device unleashed its debug interface, debug or testing or more low level access it gives you for test. Okay, so you have to verify the magic algorithm, magic number generation algorithm. If that is weak, then every device can be root. One nice case study I have for this is, like, there was one network PLM and lock device was with us in India, which is locked by one telecom operator here. And he was selling that USB modem with where you have to insert a SIM card and it will give you internet access. So it was locked to one particular network, and it's a long time back thing. I managed to get the magic number to unlock the device, and I unlocked the device and I put some cheap internet plan on SIM card on this, like mobile internet, and it start working with all other local ISPs. Okay, so this is how it is important. And here you can see at user manual, default username for admin mode is admin, default username for user mode is user, and default password for web is null, and port is open at 8080. It's the easiest to find, right? Okay, now you have IP phone, you know how it works, it have a HTTP interface. Now what? You take your laptop, connect your IP phone with LAN cable to router, and connect your laptop to the same router. Basically, these two devices will be in same network, and just perform a network scan, like 0/24, whatever CIDR you are using. You will definitely find the IP address of the IP phone, or you can even in that screen itself you can see the IP of the IP phone. Okay, so now you got a IP. Now what? Whenever you perform a scan in embedded device on the specific, for example, IP address, you should always perform a full port scan, because these devices generally don't use standard ports. So like here I found one remote denial of service attack. So I just have to send one request to this port and device will crash. Here I found at port 1380, I found a code execution. So device debug interface was accessible on that. So I could directly connect to device and execute a root command execution, root code execution on the device. And here also I found something very critical. It was also a remote code execution. And here I found a remote denial of service attack. So this kind of ports you may see when you perform a pen test on this device. Okay. So when you perform a web application pen test, you have to spend a lot of time on content discovery, right? You have to find the endpoints, you have to find the page, like what are the accessible page, so you brute force that. Here we have everything in that small file. That is called a firmware. So now we are performing firmware analysis. So first we have to understand what is the firmware, then obtaining firmware, how you will get the firmware, then unpacking firmware, and finding vulnerabilities. Okay. So let's have a look at what is a firmware. So firmware is nothing but a file contains the file system of the device, kernel of the device, and sometimes bootloaders of the device. Okay. Not necessarily all these things are will be present in a firmware, but generally, definitely you will find a file system. If there is a kernel upgrade, you will find a kernel inside the inside the firmware. And if there is a critical boot related update, then you may find a bootloader or this kind of firmware you found at a factory. Okay. Now there are two types in the firmware itself. One is a delta firmware, one is a full firmware. So you for example, you have a smartphone which is having an operating system of 3GB, 1.5 to 3GB operating system. Generally it takes from out of your 128 GB storage, 3GB to 3 to 4GB, it's a system resource space that is for the operating system of a phone. Okay, that is the that is for the firmware of the phone. Now, many bugs are coming every month. Like Google releases patch release for Android. So now, what this manufacturer have to do? They have to take those patches and they have to put those patches in their firmware and they have to give you a firmware update. So what do you think they if they are say so what do you think if they keep sending you a firmware of 3GB, how often you will update the phone? You will see download size is 3GB. Oh my god, this is gonna take a long, right? And transferring such kind of heavy data over the network is also a challenge for them. Okay, so what these guys do, the base operating system which is running on your phone and the update, update which they plan. So the data which is changed in between those two firmwares is called a delta. So what these guys do, they send a delta to your phone and your phone will accept that delta and it gets updated. So this is how this is called a FOTA process, FOTA, firmware over the air. Okay, and in that firmware over the air process, generally they send that difference. And sometimes if there is a critical changes or or a complete build change, like if the firmware version is running on 1.x.x.x and now the new firmware version comes, that is 2.x.x.x, in that scenario they send a complete build. Okay, so you have to be you should keep eyes on the device firmware, that what you are receiving. Okay. So now you understand what the firmware is, file contents, file system, kernel, and bootloader. Okay. Now how to obtain the firmware? Some vendors, like this one guy, gives the firmware directly. You can click on download, and they can download. Sorry. They can download from their website. Okay. Other way is to obtain it from the firmware update. So you set up a proxy server at your home between your ISP router and device. So whatever, every time when you click on check for update, it will go and check at the ODM whether the firmware is available or not. If available, then it will download it. And if you have a centralized proxy server, then you can download it from you. Okay. Third is extracting from the device. So you can take a you can take access. Hello?
We can hear you.
You can so you can take access to device and then you can extract the file system from the device. Okay. And lastly, Google Docs, like index of FTP, FTP of like Google Docs are many, to FTP of the vendor or index of the vendor, then you can download the firmware. Okay. And this analyzing the traffic. So most of the smartphones or most of the vendors generally performs a silent quota upgrade. So silent upgrade over device. So when you are sleeping, at that time, maybe they push a firmware, it will install and reboot your phone sometime if required. Okay. So you should keep one, I have one proxy server at home, which sits between my router and all other devices, ISP and router. So all traffic which is going, I generally keep track of it. So most of the time I get a firmware for TV, firmware for my setup box, firmware for my many devices I have. So you should keep eye on the traffic of your device. You never know what you can get with this. So this is how you can obtain the firmware. Now you got a firmware, now what? You should directly give it to Binwalk? No, that is the dumbest thing. First, you have to perform a entropy analysis. First, you have to, why entropy analysis? Because you have to identify whether the firmware is encrypted or compressed. So if the firmware is compressed with a different file system, then you might be able to extract it. But if the firmware is encrypted and if you give it to Binwalk, Binwalk will generate a large and large and large amount of garbage, which may fill up a complete your hard disk. So once my 500 GB got full within 4 to 5 hours because the firmware was encrypted and I was trying to extract a firmware with a binwalk-me and it was just generating ZLD file and garbage. Okay. So a proper way is first you have to perform a firmware analysis whether firmware is encrypted or compressed. How you can achieve it? It is with the entropy analysis. So you have to perform a binwalk-e. It will generate a graph, something which looks like this. Okay. This looks like a Cisco firmware because it is completely encrypted. But here are something which is at the downside. Can you see it? So this part is not encrypted and this part is not encrypted, but rest everything is encrypted. Okay. So if the firmware is encrypted, then better you try to find out how the firmware is encrypted. If it is encrypted with a OpenSSL or salted password, or there is a private key private key to decrypt the firmware, that is the advanced level expectation. So if the firmware is encrypted, you should look and act accordingly. If the firmware is if the firmware is encrypted, you can extract this decrypted or this data which is not unencrypted data through which.
Okay, everyone, Kostu became aware of his video being frozen, so he's just going to troubleshoot very quickly and he'll be right back in just 1 minute. We'll see if this works. We only have a few minutes left in the presentation, but hopefully this won't require too much troubleshooting. It's always fun being virtual, right? You can never guarantee you won't have connectivity issues. Kostub, if preferred, you can rejoin just without your video presenting and share your screen. As long as we have audio, I think that's the most important part.
So is it good now?
Yeah, well, you can't see you, but we can hear you. And I think, again, that's what people are here for. So I think it makes sense for us to just continue with audio.
Yeah.
Thanks, everyone, for the patience.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So I'm just continuing audio. Looks like some issue that my device automatically changed the IP address from one to another, and that's why this Droid Cam got messed up. Okay, no problem. So we'll continue. So where were we? Firmware. So if you found some kind of this stuff, like the firmware is not encrypted, you can give a try to extracting this unencrypted section using DD, or you can take a look at hex dump of the firmware, and you can also perform a signature analysis on the firmware. So what signature analysis is? Basically, what file system that they are using, what file system the firmware is using. Like we have NTFS, FAT in Windows, EXT1234, RazorFS in Linux. So embedded have their own file system, like SquashFS, then CramFS, then UBFS, then CramFS, so YZFS, RFS, many operating many file systems are there. So these are specially designed for embedded system. Okay, so you can by performing signature analysis using BINWALK on the firmware, you will come to know what kind of file system is there. So it identifies the magic number for file system, and it gets what file system is there. Okay. So, okay, now, if you, Once you perform everything, then you should start moving towards extraction of the firmware. So if the firmware is if the unencrypted firmware is there, then you can perform a binwalk hyphen me. Hey guys, am I visible?
Yep, we can see you.
Okay, so this really looks strange when there is no camera. Okay, yeah, so sorry for the bad quality integrated camera. Okay, so extract the firmware, and then now what? You have extracted the firmware, now what? First thing, you are going to take a look at the passwd file, of course. So you can check the passwd and what are the users are present in the device, what is the password for root user, and those kind of stuff. Then secondary, the document root. So as I said, when you're performing a web application pen test, you have to discover the content. Here, the content will come to you. What content? Also source code will come to you. Okay. So from the web UI, the document root you can get. And also in embedded system, what happened is it's like there is no, since there is a, small processing, small space. What these guys do is they generally put application logic inside the web server itself. So So when the web server will get when the web server gets started, it loads the application library inside application logic inside it. So HTML, so means what we say in general, there is a LAMP stack, like there is a Apache web server, then PHP is a server side language. Here you will find everything inside of one binary. So like in this embedded system, there are web servers like GoAhead, then Boa, this kind of web server. And inside that only you will find the application logic. So like setting up a IP address of device, this kind of stuff you will find in application logic itself. Then you should take a look at shell script. So why shell scripts? Because if any shell script is running with a 777 and it is running, it is getting executed as a root, then it's a privilege escalation matter for us. Okay. And many hard-coded passwords are there. Many logics are inbuilt inside the shell script only. So like generating etc passwd on runtime when the device is booting up at that time. So what some vendors do, they don't just put inside etc passwd. They write a script while booting the device. It creates a passwd, means it just echo passwd stuff and write it to the etc passwd in Linux pen testing. Okay, so this kind of stuff is there. So you should take a look at that. Also, you can take a look at PEM files, certificates, CA certificate, all kind of CFG files, all kind of conf files. So these are the files from which you will get an understanding that how device is working, means how device work you. How device generally work, okay? Boot sequence and those kind of stuff. So that's all for the firmware analysis due to time constraint, okay? Otherwise, this is like, if you deep dive in such a topic, it's gonna take forever. It's never ending topic. Now, getting hands dirty. So what I did here is like, if you remember, our test case is still how to turn the IP phone into a botnet. So now we have connected our device. We can ping to our device and device can reach to us also. So first thing you are performing, what you are going to do is running a nmap with a full port scan. So I did a nmap with the full port scan, and as I had a user manual where I found the password is admin, and I found that web server is running on ATN 443. I found one port. One new port 7547 is open and 53 was filtered on the device. So it was showing filter because I perform a TCP scan and the port listening on UDP port. Okay, so within a minute, within a second, I just found that the telnet server is running and I connected to device on port 23 and just enter admin, and here you can see. I don't know whether you can see it. Uname hyphen a Linux 2.6.36 and UID 0 and GID 0 and flash. So you just rooted device like this in a minute, right? You didn't perform anything, just run a telnet and found 23 is open, login with the most used credential, admin, and all set. And also, what interesting information it gives, that device is running Linux kernel 2.6, so now it's 4.15 something. So you can think that how old the kernel is, and it is between 2.6.17 to 36. So if you just check a CV details or Mitre for this, you will find a plenty of attacks for this kernel. Some might be a remote, and it's not that all attack is applicable for the device, because what happened is like attack is on display driver, but since in our device there is no display driver, if that display driver is not in use, then this attack won't work. Okay. Now, I just post that I have set up a proxy connection, burp suit here, burp suit, and just enter the IP address of the device. I can see this login screen, enter admin, and yes, I logged into the device. So I say, wow, the IP phone have GUI, and GUI is pretty interesting. So here is a request. You can see Go form webs login. It's a that means the GoForm is something, it's an application which is running a GoAhead server, and where it is calling, in that application, it is calling a Go form and web login, where it is sending username, password, and logging here. Okay. So, yeah. So, this is how I logged into the device. You can see here, there is no X-frame option is present in this. In bug bounty, clickjacking is a negligible issue, but in embedded system, it's critical. I'll tell you how. Okay. Now, after browsing a device for a while, I found this interesting request, go form/sysadmin. So here you can see it's a reboot flag, user type admin, password type admin, and then remote web login port, then telnet remote legal IP. So everything is present in this one request. But you can see, can you see anything here? Apart from cookie, there is nothing on this request. So this request is vulnerable for request forgery. Okay. And lastly, every embedded device have this kind of page called diagnostic page. So to perform a ping operation or to ensure the connectivity of device, to capture the packet, this kind of thing they provide us. Okay, so I just enter here an ID and you can see here the code execution. So first I discovered this bug by performing reverse engineering on application binary and then got this. Okay, so now we have a cross-site scripting, we have a CSRF, and we have code execution. All set. Boom, like this guy, we can destroy everything. Make one fancy page with payload, just click and see the magic here. And this is how we can simply turn a simple IP phone into a botnet. So here you can see I have created one POC, test POC. We have updated the policy of organization. Kindly click on I agree for accepting the term. And when you click on I agree, as you know that the laptop is connected to IP phone in most of the cases, and that IP phone connects to the backend of the network. So your corporate laptop is reachable to your IP phone. So what this do is generally it hits to it looks for what is the IP of your IP phone first. When you click on I agree, it tries to log in with the default credentials, and it performs a request forgery, and it executes the code. So code was something like for I from 1 to 10, do ID and write it to tmp/test. So here you can see we have, with just one click, we are able to execute a code. Hope you like this session. Okay. So, it's not over yet. We have one more section, which will take another 10 minutes. Okay. So this is how we can turn IP, simple looking IP phone into a botnet. Now, we are just touch basing this section. This is a quite heavy section. I have a cappuccino espresso ready with you. Okay, so first thing, reverse engineering and exploit development. First prerequisite for this is we need to have a root over the device, root or a user over the device. Now, you might be wondering, if we have a root, then why we need to perform the fuzzing and reverse engineering? Because we have to ensure that all the other we have to ensure that all vulnerabilities should be patched. So here we have captured one process attached to a Boa server, attached to the GDB, and then we fuzzed the request. Here it was a payload, and then then the device got crashed, and okay. So I think we have a short of time, so I might not be able to cover this section. But have a good news. Training of the same talk is available on YouTube on DEF CON Red Team Village channel. So you can visit this. You can visit to this channel for understanding this section. So this was a. Hope you enjoyed the talk. I will be available on Discord for question answer. And this is Bibliography. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, everyone.